That was a marvelous introduction to the idea of culture. Dr. Singh presented. I have nothing to argue about in that case. But I am getting old, and I'm a grumpy old man, you can call me. And I work on the nastiest side of life most of the time. So I will come to this problem in a different way, because the theme, basic theme, is the relationship between globalization and culture. Firstly, the matter of culture. I agree with Dr. Singh's presentation and particularly his definition of culture, but I do want to distinguish amongst three concepts of culture. There are many concepts of culture. One anthropologist has gone so far as to enumerate 19 concepts of culture current only in the discipline of anthropology, and then went on to write a fat book on one of them. So culture has many connotations. I think in our world, in this part of the world, we are primarily concerned with three kinds of culture. One kind of culture is what Dr. Singh talks about, and I'm very grateful to him for elucidating that. In fact, he talks of two of them. The second one is implicit. The first is culture as what we could call possibly high culture, what you see on the stage. Shanta Serbjeet Singh, all her life spent studying that culture. What could we put on the proscenium stage? And that also is a valuable part of culture. Many of our classical art forms are also now available to you because of that version of culture. I am very proud of that version of culture, but that is not the only way of culture. Dr. Singh has also talked about, as he made it clear, I want to distinguish between the two clearly, culture as a kind of algorithm of everyday life, which is within us and yet not only us. It connects you to a community. To have that kind of culture, you must have a community. It is the community which holds up this culture and gives it certain coherence and meaning in everyday life. Some forms of art also falls within that. They have not yet come to the larger market, so to speak. Only a few days ago I heard a presentation on Mina art, and previously I have not seen Mina art. This is the one first person who has studied it extensively, and some of the slides he showed us was absolutely exhilarating. And he doesn't want to expose this to the world too much, because he says it is integrated with the lives of the Minas, in particularly in rural Rajasthan, so much that once you do it, it will go the way of some other art forms thrown up by the tribal India, Madhubani paintings, Valli paintings, and so on and so forth, and will be immediately be marketized. And the role that it plays as a consolidating agent that holds together a community in Minas will be, at least that part will be lost. It will become more individualistic, more competitive game, as has happened with many other art forms. I don't want to go to that part of it. So the second part of culture is that where it is part of integrated life. And that does not include only art forms. That includes also the way we think about things, the way we behave with each other, the whole human relationships we have in the communities, the language we speak, and the overall rhythm of life, if you like to call it so. It is that. That is the culture which is also very important. And finally, culture can be seen, this also was implied in Dr. Singh's presentation, as a part of a civilization. When he talks of India, he invokes a civilization, which is in dynamic, it's a dynamic sense system where different kinds of cultures are interacting, and that interaction, that contact zone, is a zone of creativity, because it is that clash of cultures, it is the dynamics released by that interaction which throws up new ideas, new forms of creativity, new epistemic interventions, and so on and so forth. So these three parts of culture are very important. And as a part of that, I will also say that the principle of culture there is to wait or scan, if you like, on behalf of a community, what it will take, what it will reject. This is an important part of that function. It cannot take at face value whatever is coming to as a good intrusion, a valuable input. It must decide what to react to and in which way. So culture has that role too. Culture as resistance, you can call it. Now, globalization is a different kettle of fish. We always talk about globalization as if it has been discovered in the 1990s in India and a little earlier in the Western world. It is mainly the globalization of financial capital. Everybody knows that globalization. I see this at the third stream of globalization. The first attempt to globalize the world was not as widespread as this. It was the Atlantic slave trade. It was a four-continent slave trade. Do not forget that. It took a toll of, new estimates suggest, something like 12 million lives. And that does not take it into account the communities destroyed, the families destroyed in Africa, and the languages destroyed. It was a devastating experience for the African continent. And if that was probably the most ambitious globalization, because if you can buy and sell human beings in the market, nothing can be sacrosanct for you later on. After that, this globalization looks a pale shadow of globalization. That's the real globalization, I would say. The second globalization came when modern colonialism entered the picture. I say modern because colonization was an experience which Asians, Africans, South Americans have faced for something like for at least 450 years, if not 500 years. But the earlier colonizations were in the style of marauding military ventures from which we have seen from ancient times. It was that colonialism's main purpose was loot and also cheap labor. Spain and Portugal specialized in that. They were justified by the Pope, who gave a bull which country should be called belong to Portugal, which should belong to Spain, where the Spaniards have a right to go, where the Portuguese have a right to go, and so on and so forth. So that was another kind of colonialism. The modern colonialism was a different kind. England and France specialized in that. In England's colonies, the sun never set. It's a country which small countries, not probably in population, I think it is 1/8 of India. It dominated the entire world virtually. And India was never ruled by more than 50,000 English. So, but this colonialism has a different kind of ambition. It has a civilizing mission. It wanted to civilize us. And I would suggest that at one point, Indian culture provided a contact zone, and this colonialism did release certain new kind of forces which were creative and were healthy, namely things. Then there was nothing called novel in India. They introduced the concept of novel, and I think it met a certain cultural requirement that particular form of writing was very important, and that is why today, if you take the first list of the most famous novelists, at least one third of them will be Indian. First 10, if you take it. So that is, India has made that, made the novel their own, exactly as some, it has some African writers have done too, that same thing. So there was this need for that kind of thing, which was not made by our concept of epics and other things. But colonialism also brought in the idea of civilization, which organized and institutionalized ways of educating people, ways of thinking, and ways of redefining communities. And believe in that community. We, after independence, we have not shed that part of the thing. And however much we like some of the words we use today, the fact of the matter is this: these words are all double-edged swords for a large section of our people, certainly a majority of our people, however nice and beautiful they might look at, look to us. At one time, we sought our certitudes from religion. Now also many people will say religion is very prominent in public life, particularly in countries like India. But this is actually not the same religion. Because the religion that existed earlier, which gave you certitudes, were in some sense, you can call it faith. People believed in something, people believed in divinities and a divine disposition. They believed that earth was permeated by the touch of the divine, and crucial sectors of life was at sanctity and could be considered sacred. I mean, to give you an example, childhood was sacred. Krishna as a Rajan in Mahabharata is not as sacred as Balakrishna in all parts of India. No, childhood has sanctity of a certain kind. That is gone, as you can, if you read your newspapers regularly, you will see that. You don't have to mention that. The concept of femininity, particularly associated with reproductivity, as opposed to productivity, had a certain kind of priority, certain kind of serious implications, because in a sense, in an agricultural society, the idea of femininity mediated between nature and human being. Nature also was sacred. That sanctity nature has lost. You can read it in the newspapers. I don't have to tell you about that. Now, from that world, we have come into a world where the older sanctities are eroded. We are coming to the world where we don't have that relationship with the divine and the faith. Now, faiths, for that matter, gods and goddesses do not protect you. You protect gods and goddesses. That's the main difference between religion as it exists today in public life and religion as it existed earlier. At that time, gods and goddesses protected you. This is what Vivekananda dreamt in a temple in Kashmir when he went to pray in a Kali temple at that. And he said, "Mother, why you have been subjected to such humiliation by conquerors and others? We should protect you." And he heard, in his vision, he heard Kali saying to him, "Do you protect me or do I protect you?" I think that's a question we can ask to a lot of people who today try to protect religion and the gods and goddesses of India today. But that's a different story. I don't want to go into that. Now, I just want to end by reminding you that today increasingly it is the last meaning of culture, which I almost mentioned casually, culture as a form of resistance has become extremely important. Because all around us we see the communities which held together these cultures, Dr. Singh has referred to that also, are increasingly under attack. Because a modern nation state, for the sake of efficiency, control and management, today doesn't want an intervening, mediating presence within individuals and the state. Increasingly, we are seeing not only in India, in large parts of the world, even when it's full-fledged democracy, under a democratic governance also, the individual stands naked in front of the state. Because one by one, we are either demolished or weakened all the intervening structures. We have nothing to fall back on, nothing which will speak on our behalf as a community. And I want to draw your attention to the fact that in the last, just to give you one example, there was only in one census, we were honest enough to really ask the people, what is the language, what is your mother tongue? And that census showed that India had 1500 languages. 40 years after that census, 35 or 40 years after that, Ganesh Devi, a linguist himself, mounted a people's survey of languages in India only 2 years ago. And the results show that only 1200 languages survive now. 300 has died in the last 40 years. India has 1500 languages, now it has 1200 languages. It is a country of enormous diversity, that also he has mentioned. But few people mention that diversity itself is our saving grace. That diversity also means that we are living in a cultural world where forms of resistance are there, where we can bank upon, we can use or exploit or rediscover. That part of the story has to be narrated. And unfortunately, we have found new divinities. As the old religious thought, faiths have died out, religion has become a religious ideology. So, and it includes now new divinities. And some of them are nation state, development, the idea of progress. Each of these ideas are a way of dividing the people of those who are developed and underdeveloped, the progressive and the backward, the secular and the non-secular, and so on. So I don't shock you here at the moment, but I was just forcing you to think that each of them have become tools of dividing people. So in India there is a great debate on who nobody now says that I don't believe in secularism. There is now difference between genuine secularists and pseudo secularists. In every step, that those who are for development or against development. So we, in the meanwhile, while arguing on this, we have built 12,000 dams, 380 of them large dams. Yes, I'm just finishing. All I want to tell you that we have to learn with a touch of robust skepticism in the world in which we live. I'm not a pessimist, I'm optimistic that Indian culture will survive. But we will also have to recognize that the culture we are talking of is not only the high culture. Not even that. This civilization always lived with an undersight and a margin. And that dynamic of the civilization partly dependent on that. We probably have to look at the marginalized and substratum of Indian civilization to reinvent ourselves. Thank you very much.